but it actually didn't happen until last week on a day off for the band in Melbourne. In the meantime, of course, Mick's offsider Keith Richards made some fairly controversial comments about drugs, his own use, and the people who sell them, and he copped a fair bit of flack as a result. So when Mick sat down for our chat and had some fun at the expense of Shane Warne and his situation, I asked Mick about the reported comments of his bandmate, Keith Richards.
Yeah, the thing was, I never read what he actually said. All I read was the Salvation Army retort. I know actually what he said. I don't, you know, these things are always like, what he said and then what was actually printed is one thing, and then what the Salvation Army said and what, I don't know, you know, I never read it, because it wasn't a Sydney newspaper, I don't think, and I was in Sydney at the time.
What he's quoted as saying is that drugs aren't so bad, it's the people who sell them that are the real problem.
Well, yeah, okay. You got to buy them from somebody. Oh, meet my drug dealer, he's a really nice guy. They really are nice people, no, that's true, from my knowledge.
Do you wish he hadn't said what he
They're
said?
They're mostly creeps, drug dealers. But, I mean, the thing about drug dealers is that you don't want to be friends with drug dealer, you know. I mean, the guy is not supposed to be your friend, you know, really. It's not the idea.
I guess the bigger question is, do you wish Keith hadn't said that? And what sort of responsibility should public figures have?
People have a view about... There's a lot of views about, you know, drugs and what you do and what you... you know, what's up to you. You know, some people have the view it's up to me to drink what I want, you know. I think it's the legality of certain... Some drugs are legal, some drugs aren't legal. Alcohol's legal. And some other drugs are not legal. The point is... And lots of people want other drugs to be legal in some countries now, or more or less in England, marijuana is more or less legal now. I mean, to all intents and purposes, it's legal. And... but it's still illegal to sell marijuana. Someone's got to, if it's legal to smoke it, you've got to get it from somewhere. So in Holland, you buy it in a shop, you know, which is licensed. So some drugs are legal and some drugs aren't. And it's society sort of moved towards changing the laws on some things and another. There was a time in America when alcohol was illegal, you know. Didn't really seem to do any good.
Just finally on that subject, for Keith to say, you know, the drugs are okay, but it's the people who aren't, it's kind of okay for him. He's got lots of money, he's got nice, beautiful people around him all the time. Whereas heroin, a friend of mine lost his son last week from a heroin overdose, which is, you know, ripped the family.
I don't personally think drugs are wonderful, lovely things. I took lots of drugs, and I don't really think that they're that wonderful. I mean, it doesn't stop people dabbling and taking them and trying them, and I think that it's a bit impossible to stop people trying them out. But I personally don't, you know, I took drugs for years and years, and I didn't think they were that great, to be personal. Looking back in it, I don't think they're that great.
You guys are the ultimate survivors, I suppose, aren't you, in many senses of the word?
Yeah, I guess, you know, surviving people, surviving band, you know, survive a lot of things, ups and downs, mostly ups.
Well, you've done more than that.
I like to think a little bit more than that, you know. That sort of survival thing that, oh, they're great, or oh, he's great, you survive this and that, it doesn't really appeal to me very much.
Welcome to Australia.
Thank you.
Should we call you Sir Mick?
You can call me anything, as they said, but usually everyone calls me Mick. I mean, some people who get titles get, like, really carried away with them, can't...
Can't wait
to put them on their letterheads and all that sort of thing. I mean, good luck to them, whatever, you know.
We've cancelled and rescheduled this chat a few times. You haven't been 100%. What's...
No, I had a terrible cold. The Enmore was a tough one. I was, like, really out of it on that day. That was the worst day.
That was a great
show. It was a great show.
People said to me, why are they playing this little show? And my reaction was, A, they want to, and B, they're the past masters at creating hype, I guess is the word, at the beginning of the tour.
Thing was that we actually did quite a few shows like that, and we had actually enjoyed them, because it's just a very different thing from playing in an arena show or whatever else we do.
Because you don't make money out of a show.
No, you don't make any money, but I mean, it's a nice night.
It's
a fun night, and you get to play, and you... Well, the other thing is we got to play... we must have done, I don't know how many of these shows, maybe 8 or 9 of those theatre shows, and we got to play tunes that we hadn't really done, and they don't really work in arena shows, but they work great, you know, sort of these soul ballads.
one guy said to me walking out, you didn't play Jumpin' Jack Flash. I said, you missed the whole point of the show. I mean, this was a show for the...
We played it the other nights in the arena, you know.
Yeah, the well-publicised Enmore show was a one-off for the true believers, the band playing some old favourites, some interesting stuff, giving the 2,000 fans lucky enough to score a ticket the feeling that they were in on something very special. Now, up next, Jumpin' Jack on Wacko Jacko. Lots more Mick right after the break. Today, of course, our exclusive interview with Mick Jagger. Now, look up the words rock star in the dictionary and you'll see a 10x8 photo of this bloke. He's been living it and doing it for 40 years now. And after all that time, it would seem that the main challenge is not getting there or staying there, but keeping it interesting.
Yeah, you've got to get yourselves interested, I think, in this. I mean, otherwise it's just a boring repetition. And the show, it's really difficult. It's a fine line to sort of please people like the bloke who wanted to hear Jumpin' Jack Flash and, you know, go. And so in the arena show, you know, we do play quite a few tunes that are not particularly well-known, as well as the well-known ones. And they don't, you know, it depends. Sometimes the audience, I think, is a bit quizzical about why we do that. So, and when we play the very big shows, which we're not actually doing in Australia, when we get to Japan, we'll probably play...
Outdoor shows.
We'll play, yeah, they're actually stadium, indoor, dome.
Tokyo Dome.
It's 40,000. Baseball stadium. You know, we'll play another mixture there. So, you know, it's a fine line to find the right set list for the right place and the wrong, you know, it's just... Because for us, it's... We try and change it up and keep it interesting.
What are you going to play in China?
You know, I haven't quite done the set list for China yet. I think the more well-known ones. There's a few we can't... Well, I don't know if we can play them or not. There's a few songs of ours being banned in China. But,
oh, like...
I don't know which ones. I have to look it
up. Gotta find that out.
I don't know.
What, you guys getting clapped at IELTS in China?
Who knows?
Hey, are you enjoying your time here? You've been getting out and about and seeing...
Yeah, I've been out and about. We've had, you know, the odd day off. And I said I have my kids here. So, yeah, so I've been, you know, going out a bit more.
That's good.
Yeah.
You can't, they get sick of being locked up in a hotel.
No. I went out today on a boat trip and, you know, get out in the park, by the frisbee.
Speaking of your kids, the papers are full of reports that Elizabeth's not going out with that old bloke anymore. Your reporter has been happy about that.
Not at all. I don't mind who she goes out with, as long as I think they're okay people. And I'm not... She's old enough to make her own choices and she wants to ask me about them, that's fine.
Is it hard reading about every facet of your life in the papers, or do you read them? I'm sure you do.
I read some of them. I don't read them like a religion. Actually, I have a thing when I don't read tabloid newspapers anymore that... I mean, just generally, I'm not saying I don't read things about my family if they're stuck and someone shows me them. But I don't read tabloid newspapers. It's quite a good thing, really, after...
You don't miss them?
You don't miss them at all. It's kind of addicted, you know, like... It's like gossip itself is very addictive, you know. And tabloid newspapers is mostly gossip. And it's kind of addictive, you know, and I think it's... I made a New Year resolution, and what's not this last one, the one before, not to read any. And I've kind of stuck to it, so I think, you know, it's kind of good.
If you don't read tabloid newspapers, do you watch tabloid television?
No.
You up on this Michael Jackson stuff?
I'm pretty up on that. I did actually watch the Michael Jackson.
What do you make of all that?
I couldn't work out who's more ghastly. The journalists. But Michael Jackson, how could anyone be so stupid as to do a television show of your private life and not control it? You know, I don't know one celebrity that would do that in a million years.
And have sign off on the thing?
And not have sign off on the thing. And they would have given you that.
To get
the stuff they would have given you, yeah, you approval or not approval.
He would have looked at it and gone, hang on a sec.
Yeah, he would have said, well, obviously he's really badly advised. And
so did the guy set him up, obviously?
Set him up? I don't really know any more than what we read. I've no idea, really. I never asked. I meant to ask about, but I haven't. But, I mean, first of all, why would he do that in the first place? And secondly, why would you do it without signing off, which you would get if you asked? Right? It's a normal thing. And the journalist, so ghastly, that Martin Bashir, seriously ghastly person. I mean, he's awful. All his awful, cantish sort of interiorising of, I was worried about Michael. I mean, come on, isn't it? No, and it was, there were some obvious setups there that I think, you know, making it more exaggerated than it really was. I mean, you just could have showed it without any comment, you know, to be honest. But it wasn't enough for him. And even the American version was even worse, because in America they had Barbara Walters in between commercials making her comments on it all, this moralistic. It was seriously awful, the whole thing. It was, yeah, it was pretty gripping, though. Grippingly awful.
There you go, there's your tabloid thing coming before.
I told you.
Well, listen, thank you for your time, and thanks for the great show.
Thank you so much.
And is this the last time we'll see the Stones in Australia?
I have no idea. I can't look into the future anymore than anyone else. Goodbye.